Six, this is James from Metallica, watching Channel V Australia.
Landed here in LA in like 1980.
From Denmark?
Yeah, in Denmark, and I sort of took one look around and said, help, I'm in sort of heavy metal wasteland here. You know, I mean, you'd turn on the radio and you'd hear, you know, the latest from REO Speedwagon. That was, you know, over in Europe the last couple of years, bands like Iron Maiden and Def Leppard and Motorhead and Saxon and so on were like really blossoming and kicking up quite a bit of an excitement over there. Most of the metal bands that we're really influenced by, like say the Motorheads and the Diamondheads and the Saxons and all this stuff from the early 1980s in England, they were hard rock and metal's answer to the punk thing, because they sort of took the punk attitudes
punk
and so on, and then
also
infused it with sort of more traditional hard rock music. We just followed our instincts and did what we wanted to do. That then happened to be labeled by everybody else, oh, something new and different and exciting, because we were the first band in America to really draw so heavily out of those European influences. You know, we got Metallica together in LA in 81, October 81. Went through a couple different lineup changes, moved up to San Francisco in 83, went out to New York, 83, caught our first record, Kill 'Em All. By that time we had gotten both Kirk Hammett and Cliff Burton in the band, and off we went. Seem to be appealing to a lot of different groups, which is a lot of different groups of people, where it's too easy just to say, you know, white male 12 to 17, you know, it's, you know, because there's always, you know, just contradictions to that. You get the party people, you get the people that are very into the lyrics, which are probably some of the more serious people. You get the people that are very into just the energies that are being created. You get some of the people that are into some of the musicianship and some of the maybe more musical intricate things that we do. I think with Jason, I mean, the guy's an incredibly talented bass player and can, you know, play bass, you know, and like Steve Vai plays guitar, you know, just doodle right along with the best of them and do a lot of really quick shit and stuff like that.
The first thing that people would notice about the your guitar style going back to the early days is just the incredible speed and intensity of it.
Overall, there's just a general aggression to the music and the way we approach, you know, the instruments. We play with a lot of distortion, a lot of low end, and just a certain feel, an aggressive feel that finds itself throughout all the music. I mean, there won't be any one particular song that we have that's like pretty all the way through. Sooner or later, it gets real heavy and ugly. He knows what words go best as far as singing. Phrasing is concerned, he knows what he wants to say when he sings.
Huh? Not cool, cool, cool.
I'm just the one that's mainly the mouth.
That thing right there is this thing.
Right, this is cool.
Oh! Okay, I get it.
The last thing that we want this to be is a business, you know, when we walk around like, you know, businessmen dressed up as musicians or anything. But you gotta be careful that you also don't let the situation take advantage of you. So you gotta stay informed, you gotta stay aware, and you gotta know what's going on around you. And I'm the one that in the band does most of the involvement with, you know, your booking agents and with the, you know, accountants. cut Ride the Lightning in Denmark in the spring of 84. Spent most of the rest of 84 in Europe, actually, like touring with Twisted Sister. We played festivals, we did a lot of stuff. Like the fall of 84, things really like went up to like a different level. On the road with Ozzy for about 6 months in 86 then to support that album, which was great. That was like the best tour I've ever been on still, like 10 years later.
It's always hard to get over something like that, especially when it's a close friend like that, you know. You grew up in the band. And to lose someone like that is pretty difficult, no matter what, how, or why, you know.
Cliff, I think, just was always like this, the main sort of the gung-ho guy about whatever came in our way. We just, you know, rammed right through it always. And obviously, we've had a lot of down things. Obviously, the worst one by far being the thing with Cliff's death. But if Cliff was here, I know that he would just say, yeah, we just basically gave the big finger to everybody and we proved to everybody that we stood our own ground and basically anything's possible.
Should Not Be was, boy, it was a whole mythos, Lovecraft mythos that Cliff and Kirk as well were really into. And the thing that Should Not Be was one of his creatures that was supposedly buried within the earth waiting to arise, and his followers are, you know, calling him. So the thing that Should Not Be was basically one of the characters. The thing that Should Not Be, I think, is probably the ultimate in Metallica heavy. Face the thing that should not be.
Back in the road, it's not surreal. From something I must feel, but can't look forward to.
Put out an album full of topics that were very current and up to date with, you know, the social problems that are going on now, and there are absolutely no compromises whatsoever. Throughout the beginning to the end of the album, In the creation of it, we've stuck to that theme, you know, just doing what we want to do.
Hold my breath as I whisper, dear. Oh, please, God, wake me.
Just like a piece of meat that keeps on living.
Once we did the one video, the first one, once we did that, I think we realized that we could use this medium in the same way that we use, you know, records and whatever to get creative ideas across, to have fun with it and not be intimidated by it. We were just talking about what it would be like to be in a situation which the guy in the song is obviously in, where he basically can't see, hear or speak and doesn't have any limbs or anything, just basically shut off from everything that goes on around him. And then we found out that there was a book written about a guy in a similar situation, just set up against the background of World War I, which was obviously this book called Johnny Got His Gun. And that's basically when we took the idea and set it against that background.
I don't know whether I'm alive and dreaming or dead and remembering.
How can you tell what's a dream and what's real when you can't even tell when you're awake and when you're asleep?
Where am I?
We got a copy of the movie, which wasn't actually that easy to track down, and looked through it and so forth. And I think somewhere along the lines of watching the movie and so forth, somewhere a few ideas were just born that maybe here was actually sort of the foundation of something that could possibly turn into some sort of very weird and very different, you know, promotional video than what other bands had done.
Kill me. Over and over again.
We threw ourselves out into it, knowing all the time the agreement we had with Elektra Records, which was that if this did not work, see ya, straight in the garbage can at their expense. I think that somewhere along the lines, that agreement was really what sort of made us really actually want to throw ourselves out into it, because if we felt that we were stuck in a situation that we couldn't get out of if we weren't happy with the outcome, then I don't think we would actually have done it. No.
The impression that the video leaves is a pretty heavy impression.
Keep the home fires burning.
It sticks out like a sore thumb. It isn't like your standard video.
Well, she's a nice girl, but her bad girl's better. Me and Willie just can't help come when she calls.
It wasn't as much winning as it was actually playing and establishing ourselves as a genre that, you know, that is a major force, you know, that has something to say.
The Grammy stuff was really exciting the first year, and going there and playing it.
It was pretty surprising when they said Jethro Tull, because I thought AC/DC were going to get it. I didn't expect, you know, Jethro Tull. I was like, huh? Wait, something's wrong here.
I'd be lying to you if I said that it's not something that's obviously an honor and it's like cool, but important in the way that make or break, absolutely not. But I mean, obviously it's cool when somebody sits there and acknowledges what you're doing. We go in the studio and we record this thing in about a half hour, give or take a day or two, you know what I mean? And it's a cover song from like 12, you know, 15, 18 years ago. What, yeah, it's what, 73, yeah, it's about almost 20 years old. And it comes out on an Elektra compilation album, and it's like we win a Grammy for it over like fully fledged, you know, albums by, you know, Judas Priest and Megadeth and Anthrax and stuff, which is kind of funny. The Ride the Lightning album to Master Puppets to Injustice for All were all different albums from each other, but kind of in the same direction. And I think this album just kind of took like a sharp turn. The difference this time is that instead of taking, you know, like five riffs and cramming them all into one song, now most of the songs only really have like one or two riffs in it, so it's a little more, just kind of sticks more to one thing.
What are you writing about on this record?
It's more positive this time around. It's you know, it's heavy, but it's not the death doom kind of negative kind of thing we had going on the Justice. Justice was more kind of complaining about things. I think this one's kind of accenting the good stuff on how, you know, certain things in your life.
Probably the biggest song of your career, right there. The first song I heard.
Yeah. We've not really been too happy with any of the mixes on the last three albums, and we were sitting there when we started writing the songs last summer, you know, who should we get to mix this record? Because we thought, you know, we'd made the last three albums with Fleming Rasmussen, and we didn't see any reason why we shouldn't make this one with him. So we're sitting there talking about who we should get to mix it, and we thought one of the best sounding records of the last couple of years was the Motley Crue album that he made, Dr. Feelgood. That he had the ability to make like the best Motley Crue album, and the Bon Jovi album that he was involved with was like the best Bon Jovi album. It's like he seemed to be able to just make, you know, bring out the best in whatever bands he was working with. So we had our manager call him up and say, you know, are you interested in mixing this record? And he said, yeah, but I'd also really like to produce it if they're interested. And we're like, well, wait a minute, we're Metallica, you know, nobody produces us, you know, nobody comes into our little inner circle. But after a while, we just kind of said, well, wait a minute, you know, maybe we shouldn't be so stubborn.
I thought, well, here's these guys that have struggled for such a long time to get to someplace, and now that they're there, you know, it would be so easy for them to just take what they've had a little bit further and put it out, and I'm sure that they could sell another 5 million records and everything would be fine. But no, they're going to take a chance.
Is
sounded really good.
He's really been able to feel the right ways to guide us and that kind of thing, you know each of us and our little quirks and that kind of thing to make everything just flow, and really he's the best at capturing our performance. You know, he really knows how to get you just so in your psychology, just to, man, you can play better than that, I know you can do better than that, or whatever he needs to say in order to pull it out to get it onto the tape.
The figure that goes into the verse, bad or da 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 da, and then the first two bars we gotta get.
Yeah.
Okay?
It's easier to go in and sort of leave your emotions at the counter when you walk into the studio, but this time we wanted to get some of that down on tape, and that was not as easy as I thought it was going to be, to really try and get an attitude and a feeling down on tape that we'd never had. That really took some time to loosen up in the studio enough to do that.
Do a track from top to bottom. Okay?
All the shit moved way out. Or it wasn't so far in this little booth thing.
I'm not sure, James.
As Bob Rock put it, he wanted to capture the moment. And capturing that moment took a long time. Yeah.
Never really been that career conscious. I mean, when we started this band 10 years ago, it was not like, oh, we're striving to be number one all over the world or anything, but sure, I'll take it. I know that we didn't alter our course in terms of you know, trying to preconceive things or whatever. It's like, all that's going on the last couple of months, it's just because of, that's what came from us. And the radio and you guys and everybody picked up Enter Sandman and The Unforgiven and so on, but it's still been on our terms. A year ago when we sat down and had a vision about what this record was gonna turn out, it's like, we're there times about 10 million. You know what I mean? So it's, I'm pretty happy about it. Just kind of deals with this guy who kind of, this abused guy who goes into like a room and basically grows old in this room, and then all these weird things happen. It's not like the most direct video. It's a video you have to see a few times. Never free, never me. So I dub thee.
The room is a sanctuary from all his abusers.
Man, and when I saw it the first time, I had no idea what the hell was going on. Forever trusting who we are,
and nothing else matters.
Or nothing else matters. We just wanted to show kind of more of a personal side of us, and I think we're more comfortable with showing that now.
Tour, we didn't know it was going to be 2 years long. If we did, I don't know if we would have left.
Yeah.
I don't know if we would have. It would have been a tough road if we knew it was 2 years that we'd be out.
First couple shows, I think it was kind of, you were kind of conscious of it and almost awkward and uncomfortable about people always being at your back or somebody always being somewhere. As soon as you got used to it, though, it was like if there was only a few people at some places, like James said, you know, the fire marshal only let 20 people in there or something, and it wasn't feeding you, you know, from there you're going, oh man, you kind of let down. Or you really got used to that charge from those people in there.
It's the 1991 MTV Video Music Awards.
They like actually came to us and like begged us to be on the show, and it's kind of funny because we've like, you know, MTV and Metallica have never exactly gone hand in hand. It was just kind of funny that there they were knocking on the door saying, please come and play.
And you know, they even
play the awards show.
The even funnier thing is we predicted it. We predicted that would happen.
The 1992 MTV Video Music Awards.
And the winner is
Metallica, Enter Sandman.
I guess these things just went down in value. If we can win one, I guess anybody can, huh? Hi, James. Hi, Jason. Look, we won an award, huh?
Hope your hand's better, James. Okay.
Really stands out. It's like you have all this stuff, all this normal blah blah blah, and then all of a sudden there's our video. And whether you like it or not, I don't think you can take away from the fact that it really is different.
The way we look at the other guys though that are still around, like Aerosmith and those kind of bands, Black Sabbath or whatever, I think we still look at them with maybe even more respect now that we have tasted some of what they were tasting when we were bowing to them, you know, that kind of thing. And now that we've met them and become their peers, it's a pretty huge thing to have a mutual respect with those kind of people.
When we started off, there were a lot of people that were laughing at us and pointing fingers with Metallica. They can't play, they can't write, they can't do anything. It's like there's a major...
something like...
That I don't like mixing music and politics together. When we go play certain countries, there's always these political questions, you know, oh, aren't you here to save the kids and all this, you know? We're here to play music, you know, and it's just one of our feelings that we're trying to get out. And I think other celebrities or figures that use their popularity to promote certain political causes, I feel it's wrong.
Or beliefs.
Just because they're popular doesn't mean they're smart.
There's a very fine line between telling people what to do and informing them. And sometimes when you go up and start telling people, well, this blah, 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 it can come across as telling people what to do and what to think. And that's one thing that we always stay away from as much as possible.
Beelzebub has a devil put aside for me, for me, for me.
People tend to identify you with a certain cause or a especially politically, and this is way beyond that, more kind of a social type thing. So we felt that, we had no problem.
The show must go on, and we'll start with an American band, 3 times Grammy Award winners. Please welcome Metallica.
When they asked us to do this, I mean, there was no way that we wouldn't do it. And obviously for Freddie Mercury, for the respect of Queen, and also I think that of any thing that you could do an awareness thing for, still, AIDS is still the thing that most people just don't really, a lot of, in rock and roll and stuff like that, it's still...
Yeah, it's still sex and rock and roll.
And it still perplexes me of the amount of ignorance there still is about AIDS in rock and roll. We started touring when we were 18 and 19 years old. That was 10 years ago. Those first 3, 4, 5 years, I mean, we lived every cliche, we lived every dream that you think about when you're a little kid, and you just go out on tour and you live it all, you know. And then after a few years of that, it's like, okay, you know, we got married and kind of settled down. I mean, we can still go out there and raise hell with the rest of them, but in terms of the sex side of it, you know, we all have steady relationships and stuff like that, so we just keep it pretty low profile. We're doing about 25 stadium dates across North America and Canada. I think there's a lot of people that would like this thing to fail. And I would like to show all those people that would like this thing to fail that, hey, we can make this work. And a lot of the stadiums that we've talked to and so on, there's, you know, for instance, we're not playing Philadelphia, for instance. Why are we not playing Philadelphia? Because the stadium there doesn't want Metallica and Guns N' Roses. So it's like, I'd like to show the places that don't want this tour that we can go in and make this happen.
Might not have given the time to go check out Metallica.
And now they
just by themselves go to see him with Guns N' Roses and they go, hey, these guys aren't so bad after all.
3/4 into the set, song Fade to Black, we got some pyro stuff. And excuse me, my God. But there's some flames that happen, and there was some miscommunication. Us standing in the wrong place, basically.
Sing for us on this one here.
It was some additional pyro, and instead of our pyro man kind of making it clear to at least myself, saying, you know, the new pyro was here, and still we have the old stuff, but I didn't know we had the old stuff also. So I was standing on the grill, and the grill work, you can't really see what's under there, especially in, you know, when it's dark. You know, there's monitors, there's lights, and there's big flames under there now.
Went out afterwards, just a couple minutes later, and talked to everybody and said that, you know, James has been hurt and he's on his way to the hospital, but we'll come back and play a show for you, you know, later on. So just thanks for being our friends, and you know, we'll see you in a few months, whatever, to hang out. Mm-hmm. And everybody's just like, cool, cool, no negative anything.
It's later.
And it's, you know, they're very cool, and then later on, yeah.
Sometimes, you know, there's a lot of stupid people that just follow and whatever.
Right.
It'll just snowball into a big thing, and there's sometimes you can't control it. But if you catch it before it really gets out of hand, then you should be able to kind of control things.
I don't remember any kind of serious problems at any Metallica shows when it was just Metallica playing. Or Metallica, and even an opening act, there really wasn't ever any, you know, there's always been fights and maybe a broken nose here and a dislocated shoulder there, something like that, but, you know, there's not really...
And that's just the crew.
First few hours that we were in Montreal and James was in the hospital, we were all kind of hanging in the balance, wondering if we were going to have a band, you know, or what was going to happen, really.
I think everyone was in shock.
We stayed at that gig until about 4:30 in the morning that day, trying to trying to learn how to play guitar and tie some loose ends together, you know, and stuff like that, make some decisions, you know, and when we found out what was going on with him.
And they told me I was still in the band, it was like, whew, all right, thanks, guys. Yeah.
John came in and some parts, like in The Unforgiven, when James plays, you know, finger picking on a classical guitar on a stand and then to the electric and back and forth. You know, the first day that we auditioned John, he came in and did that thing right away, note for note, no problem. So we pretty much knew he was our man.
Yeah. He's done it before too, yeah. So we kind of know him. And
he's been around the band for a long, long time.
He's on the crew for quite a while. And he stepped in when I broke my wrist on the Aussie thing. In
86.
Yeah. Arms all right, just the back of the hand was basically the most burnt part, pretty deep second degree. So, you know, your hand, yes, here it is, man. I got this glove on now, which is pretty cool. Kind of acts as a second skin. It's real breathable and yeah, it keeps it kind of clean. And you know, the skin on the back of your hand has to stretch a lot, and it's really thin, so it takes a while to heal.
Kick-ass live project, man.
9 hours, man. Strap yourself in.
What's going on is that basically this project that started out as this kind of like, let's do a live type of video from the last tour has turned in to this kind of mega project that is now the biggest thing that we've ever been involved in. We thought that it would be nice to kind of put some different flavors, some different vibes on all the different gigs and the different atmospheres and attitudes and so on. So we got three different guys mixing the three audio segments and two different guys doing the two video segments. So you basically got five different guys putting their individualities on what's going on.
We got this. These are all the images. Look, Metallica. We don't have enough tapes. Look, Metallica. 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 Metallica everywhere. Metallica. Metallica.
It's enough to make me weep.
We have 83.5 hours of film that we shot to get this right here. 2.5 hours. I know the ratio seems to be a little out of whack, but we wanted to make sure we got every expression, every innuendo, every drop of sweat, every head-banging element that is the essence of Metallica.
We basically came up with the idea of dumping all the different gigs and all the different things basically into like a Metallica type of road case.
Chocked full of metal.
There came a point in hard rock where a lot of that stuff got a little too silly with names and, you know, logos and all this kind of stuff. So we were trying to bring it down to making more of a, like of a comical approach, you know, instead of, you know, these Dungeons and Dragons and beasts and all this crap that everybody, you know, and skulls and all this. So it's like, you know, we have James's little guy here, and he drew one night when he was really drunk, and you know,
and
we just
that. And that's how much they pay for the art,
right?
We wouldn't have passed it up for the world. I think we're always looking to go new places and check stuff out, you know, the Metallica way, and you know, that it was a very eye-opening experience, you know, to see how certain people live, you know, on a, like, it's almost a different planet up there.
It was like going to camp, like a huge adventure. You had to be ready for anything.
How you doing, Matt? Good. How you doing? You got a post?
Yeah. What do you want to see?
Metallica.
Oh, yeah?
Metallica. Huh.
So what do you guys do for fun here?
Walk around, stay up late.
You stay up late?
Yeah.
What do you do?
Walk around.
It was really an adventure. You know, we were there for maybe 30 hours or something like that. But just to the way we had to get up there, you know, this plane to this little sputtery plane, and then you finally get down there and you just see that everything is so different and how, you know, fortunate we are and the things that we get to do, all of us here, you know, and that kind of thing, and how they have to, their work that they have to do and seasonal work and these kind of things. We went on stage, it was 37 degrees, but it was just like stripped down, just like old days, a couple amps behind us. We were playing like on picnic tables or something all taped together. It was amazing.
How was it, man? How was it?
Excellent! Yeah. Best thing I've ever seen, man!
Where do I take this pain of mine? Stays right by my side.
Excuse me, sir. What brings you here so late in the evening?
Oh, I gotta get the new Metallica album.
Why don't you just wait till tomorrow? It'll still be here.
It's not the same.
No?
You gotta have the experience.
Metallica!
The 5-year waiting period to get some new material out to all our friends out there is just how it had to be. The Black Album put us on the road for about 2 years, and then we needed to take a little time off. Then we did the live thing, and then started writing this thing. So that's how it works. It's really long. There's a lot of music on it. There's a lot of looser stuff comparatively to what we've kind of done before. A little more simple, but loose is definitely the word.
Well, I asked people in the last few weeks, you know, what do you think? They go, it's really different, but it's totally Metallica. I mean, there's not a better way of summing it up.
We usually have most of the stuff written when we go in. We like to be prepared when we go in. But this time, we were still writing because it eventually we ended up with 30 songs. Yeah. You know, we said, well, let's stop at 20. Let's stop at 25. We just had a lot of good material. And so we were still writing while we were in the studio. We were recording other songs. Lars and I'd go back to the dungeon and create some more. It's like, we gotta stop.
Just one more thing, just to play the king. But the castle's crumble and you're left with just a name. Where's your crown, king?
Take each song with the words or whatever and bring it into your own little circle, into your own world, you know, put it through your filter and make it your own. That kind of thing, rather than being so pinpointed or defined or something. We're singing about the church, we're singing about whatever happens, you know, somebody. It's very open to your interpretation. That's the whole idea.
It's gotten a lot easier for me to get pen to paper and not really have to think so much about what I'm gonna write about.
Okay.
There's a lot more flowing out, which is great.
Okay.
And there's plenty of fuel, you know, childhood. The way it was, it fueled me for the rest of my life lyrically.
The most of the songs were written there in Lars's dungeon, did that thing, but the one that actually happened, the first single that came out, Until It Sleeps, was one that we did together for the first time, doing it together in the studio while we were sitting there with Bob Rock, and that just jammed on a song one day from an initial idea of James' bass riff or something, and it took from there, and that became the first single.
I just wanted to do the video that would get a reaction out of people, and that video could get a reaction out of people.
Definitely. It's like,
that was really funny. Oh my God, a couple of them are wearing makeup.
A lot of people are making a big deal about the haircuts. Does that really mean much?
Well, I don't know. It's kind of signifying the demise of metal a bit.
All right, how are you?
And that is the part of metal is big hair?
I think so, yeah.
People haven't seen pictures of us for 3-4 years, so I think people have this vision of, like, we sat down and had a band meeting all planned to, like, okay, let's all get our hair cut together. We all went to the barber shop together. We got a, you know, three for one, three for four discount. I love just kind of screwing with people's thoughts about the way all this is supposed to be, how you're supposed to look, how you're supposed to act, how you're supposed to, just, you know, all these type of things in, like you say, this really conservative world of hard rock and heavy metal. It keeps solidifying this fact that, you know, all these people in the hard rock metal world are so narrow-minded, and they should really be, you know, have these things challenged. And if better or worse, if we're the band that can do that, then, you know, it's fun to do that.
For the whole haircut thing, you know, when you look back at that, you know, do you shake your head and go, jeez? Or do you just look at it and smile?
Just look at it and grin and see how fine I look.
Yeah. There's no other, you know, music form where these things really matter. I mean, you can never sit there and talk about, well, this guy or that. I mean, the only music form where to certain people it matters what you look like or how you act or whatever is hard rock, and it's just very silly.
Did their new haircuts kind of scare you a bit at first?
Man, because I have my hair long too back in Hamilton. Now look at it, baby. Wah!
What did you think of their new hairstyles?
I don't care.
No?
The music, that's all that matters.
I wish I would have done it 10 years ago.
Yeah.
Because if I'd done it 10 years ago, then right now would be year 10 of my short hair, and I would be over all the questions about it.
We're pretty good at taking a lot of things in stride, whether they're large obstacles, you know, like that, or nice things, good things.
Bring it on,
things.
We'll take it.
And one of the first things Peter Mensch told me when we did Master Puppets, Peter Mensch is the manager, like 5 years ago, was, you know, it's going to be a lot of, you know, there's going to be the big Metallica backlash.
Old Metallica is rule. All these posers come out here and say they don't know, they like Metallica, but they don't know any old Metallica. It's not as heavy as it should be.
People should like music because they like music,
right,
not because they're afraid of who's going to stand next to them at the concert.
Okay.
The people who are our true fans that like us for how we've gone about things, how we're, the integrity is the main thing in our music. They're still there, and the people who are too afraid of who likes them now, and don't want to be mixed in with the wrong crowd, man. You know, have gone away, and we're glad for that.
There are people who attach themselves to a certain era in your career, and they sentimentalize it, and they like it so much that they really can't, pull themselves away from that era. And, you know, I'm guilty of it. Everyone does it.
Rock on, Cliff. Rock on, Cliff. Hey, man, the best stuff is back then.
They kind of went, mainstream they kind of went, but the old stuff, eh? Everybody, ow!
We make music for ourselves and records for ourselves, but that's the only way it can be pure, because if it's not for ourselves, then if you start trying to alter it, or change it for somebody to appeal to this or that or whatever, what's going on in the marketplace or whatever, then you've already lost.
To me, they've gone a little mainstream, you know? Yeah. Not too much, but
very, very, very the last album they put out. Yeah. Same kind of Bob Rock attitude.
Yeah. Yeah. You think they're still metal?
Yeah, yeah. They're not as heavy. I wish they'd go back to their heavy stuff.
Since day one, we didn't want to be called thrash metal. We didn't want to be called something. You know, we wanted to be called Metallica and Metallica music, so... since day one, we've shed all the traditional, labels or the traditional road you're supposed to travel. So I think we're still doing that. We didn't finish Load, basically. So this is the rest of Load. It's not leftovers, it's not remixes, it's not any lesser songs. This is the rest of the songs that we didn't get to. Mm-hmm. With Load, after the Black Album, we wrote 30 songs and we kept writing, and we had to stop at one point, start recording. We were in there recording, and it was too much to handle. 30 songs was too much. We had to get out of there, go on tour. So we finished half of them. It was pretty amazing. We were taking Dramamine and wearing C-bands and, motion sickness, and it was pretty trippy. She survived it as well.
Yeah, she's a survivor.
Yeah, no doubt about that. Quite an intense character she is. Okay. So it was fun to work with her.
In the local Toronto newspaper a couple days ago, and it says that babies and age have helped the legendary heavy rockers go a little soft. Now, when you first look at that, what comes to mind?
How cool I look. Just because these guys grew up a little bit and decided to have a couple kids, that doesn't mean anything. I mean,
it doesn't change.
Actually made them a hell of a lot better people so far.
Yeah.
A lot of cool stuff can come from this, I think. I'm excited to see what music comes out of James once he does really get into the baby and start seeing things in a different light. It could, it doesn't necessarily mean it's going to be sappy or soupy or music or something. It could be that much uglier, that much more heavy because he's found something else that, makes him, that drives him or something like that, I think that'd be a cool thing to see.
Affected, the attitude that we go on stage with, the attitude we go into the studio with. Well, maybe it will in the future, but as of right now, we still have that fire, that juice. All sense is pain, a scare to back to the
beat, back to the beat. Oh, whoa. Live shows are always worth the buck, People only have so much money to spend on a band. There's so many bands out there that are working for the same dollar. Everybody is know they're going to get delivered to when they pay their money for Metallica show, that type of vibe.
What is it about Metallica that no other band has?
The music, the guitaring, the singing, everything. It's just great.
There's a generation of music lovers who come to age every summer, and what they do is, they come of age with Metallica, and they go out and they buy the Black Album. They like the Black Album. They go out and buy all the rest of the albums, and pretty soon, you have a 15-year-old kid buying a ticket, for the first time and seeing Metallica for the first time.
I've got all their albums. Well, this is the first concert I went to because my mom won't let me go to the other one. I was too young.
People in been able to somehow be touched by a lot of the things, you know, that James comes up to, the words he puts together. A lot of people wish they could have said them or whatever, you know what I mean? So they really are able to identify in a big way.
James!
I love him! I love him! Okay, let me go!
Is he a good songwriter?
He's amazing, man! He's amazing, okay?
There was a bunch of court battles and whatnot, and we
kicked ass,
which was great. We won something, which was amazing. Got our way. They couldn't really stop us. We really wanted to do this.
Free tickets.
Yeah.
Should all concerts be free now?
Yeah.
Hell yeah.
Because of the name Metallica, they were a little more apprehensive and a little more scared of what could happen. And I think it's a disrespect to all our fans. And really, they had the idea of what a Metallica fan was. And it's kind of a, it's kind of annoying that that's what they think, that our fans can't enjoy music at a free concert outside in a parking lot.